Tonight's focus on sustainability looks at the Valley Permaculture Alliance. It's a nonprofit that teaches Valley residents how to compost, garden, harvest rainwater, and raise chickens in their backyards, all in the name of sustainable living. Here to tell us more is Doreen Pollack. She's executive director of the Valley Permaculture Alliance. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Let's define some terms here. What does permaculture mean?
Well, if you think about taking the word and dividing it in half, permanent agriculture. So it's really about the whole notion of living more sustainably in harmony with nature. So how do you create an agriculture or even a culture that will have more long-lasting effects?
Okay, so what is sustainable urban living
mean? Well, we picked the word urban in our mission statement because really most of the folks that come and participate in our programs are from the valley areas. So they are not people who have many acres out in the outskirts of town. They're people who live in master plan communities or live in historic neighborhoods who have just a normal size lot. And they want to do something on that lot where they can grow their own food or catch rainwater and use it in the garden. So we're really focusing on folks that don't have a lot of land.
So when we hear about, and on your website you talk about interdependence of human and natural ecosystems. Again, what are we talking about there?
Right, those are pretty fancy words,
yes,
aren't
they?
Yeah, well really what it means, living in harmony with nature. If you think about how things happen in nature, there's no beginning and an end, is there? When a leaf is on a tree and it falls on the ground and decomposes, it becomes nutrients for the tree. The tree grows and it grows new leaves. So there's the interdependence of nature and things all work together in harmony.
So how do you do that? So you got a house, you got the small plot of land. I think we have some video of you with at a house. I think it's your house with a small plot of land. You're using rainwater here. I guess no, this is actually water from your washer. No, this is composting. I'm sorry, this is compost.
Right, so composting is really easy to do for folks. Composting is nothing more than taking what comes out of your kitchen, the ends of your, tomatoes and carrots and vegetables and fruits and coffee grounds and eggshells and ending up putting them with some grass in a container, mixing them up a little bit, putting a little water in it, just like you might make some spaghetti with sauce. Make sure it's all combined well and let it sit for a couple months. And voila, you have your own fertilizer.
You have a lot of your own fertilizer,
yes,
don't you?
Yes, exactly.
Yard clippings, mulching you mow the lawn, you got to, instead of throwing that stuff in the garbage, you
exactly.
throw that stuff in the...
You know, you kill the house plant, that can go in there. And even the fur from your dog. If you have a dog and it sheds a lot, you collect all that fur and throw it right in your compost. So you can reduce the amount of waste you put into your trash by about 40%. By composting.
Is it complicated? How long does it take? How long does it take from the grass clippings that go in to
anywhere from 6 weeks to 3 months, depending on how much you want to be involved. I'm a lazy gardener, so it takes mine about 3 months because I don't get in there and mix it up a lot.
So you have to keep mixing it and keep things
about
moving.
Once a week, I get a pitchfork, yeah. Toss it around like I'm dressing a salad, and that sits.
Let's talk about water now. I think again we have some video of water coming from your washer.
Yes.
And again, how does that work? How do you make that water do other things?
Well, first of all, you have to be careful what soaps you use. So I'm now using soaps that are very low in sodium. And my washing machine pump will actually force the water through some PVC piping that's been actually put underground. It comes out of like drip irrigation parts, and it really waters a basin that sits around my fruit tree. So my washing machine water and the amount of wash I do throughout a year will provide my citrus tree with half the water it needs each year.
Interesting.
So I'm using that much less municipal water, which is higher in salts because it's drinkable, potable water.
What about folks who are raising chickens? And I think on your website, again, someone was raising quail, little baby quail, in their backyards. First of all, do you need a permit for something like that?
You don't need a permit, but you do need permission from your neighbors. And I suggest to everyone that they check their city, because each city around the valley does have some different requirements. For example, in the city of Phoenix, if you have neighbors within 80 feet of where the chickens are going to live, you need to ask for permission. And that's not a hard thing to do. If you've got a good relationship with your neighbors, you just say, look, I'll bring you a couple eggs every so often. So yeah, raising chickens is a big, big deal. As a matter of fact, last year, we held our second annual Tour de Coops, which is a tour of backyard chicken coops, and 650 people on a cold and rainy Saturday toured Valley backyard chicken coops.
So when you tour these backyard chickens, what are you looking for? What kind of ideas work? What don't work so well?
Sure. Well, how does it fit into my life? I mean, is that coop going to take up my whole backyard so my dog doesn't have a place to play, or my kids no longer have a yard? No, the coops can be tucked in amongst your landscaping. We had a woman who's got a very lovely coop. It actually has a chandelier hanging in it. So you can make it kind of fit your decor, or as simple as just a lean-to.
And these are classes that people can take, things that they can learn through classes they can take through your organization.
Yes, we do about 100 classes a year, probably a variety of about 20 different classes from things. And if you think about our classes, they're all at the 101 level at a university. So very entry level, things like how do I garden, how do I grow my own food, how do I compost, and how do I do rainwater harvesting?
And for folks who live in more desert environments, some folks live in irrigated lot areas, some folks kind of halfway between, other folks live way out in the desert. Anyone can do this?
Anyone can do this. You just need to know the practical matters on how to do it. And we teach people how to take their living situation and their conditions and apply the steps that'll make it work.
Valley Permaculture Alliance, how many members do you have?
Over 6,000.
My goodness.
Yes, we've got a really great website where people can actually, it's almost like a social media site. They can talk to each other. They can post questions and they answer each other's questions. They have pictures and videos of the things that they're doing in their yard. So people learn from each other as well as from our classes and events.
And how many, could you give us, what's the average member? Give us a demographic of the average member.
I would say the average member is someone like you and I. We've also seen families with children. We've had young people. But they're people who, many of them have their own home. Maybe they don't own their home, but they have property. We have a few apartment dwellers, but most people have a yard which they can do things. So, and they've got some money to spend on classes, although I'll tell you, our classes are really reasonable. They're only $15 for 90 minutes, and so most people find that it really fits into their weekly budget.
And last question, you seeing increased interest over the years?
My goodness, yes. Our class membership has really grown, and about 50% of all the people who attend our events and classes are first time into getting into gardening.
Well, it sounds like great stuff. You must enjoy your work there with the Valley Permaculture Alliance. It looks like fun. Thanks
it
for
is.
Joining us.
Thank you.
Wednesday on Arizona Horizon. Get the latest from the state capitol in our weekly legislative update. And remember tricorder devices from Star Trek? A U of A student is developing a working model of the sensor scanning apparatus. That's Wednesday on Arizona Horizon, 5:30 and 10, right here on 8 HD. That is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.